Yes, Ross. How are you? You're still connecting to the Yes, boss, you still have not connected to the audio. Kindly connect it so that we can start the class. And where are others, Priyanka, Abu Bakr? Yes, boss, how are you? I suppose, am I not audible? Wait a minute. Yeah, my mic is working. My audio is connected. Yeah, Priyanka's Yes, Abdul, how are you? Abdul, Ross, how are you guys doing?
Fine, sir.
Everyone good?
Yes, sir.
Okay. You guys turn your cameras on in the class. So we were doing the chapter transportation in plants and animals, right? So several topics have been discussed so far. And Abdul, the
Yes.
class which you had with me, they also we did discuss the same chapter, right? We're doing this chapter, same thing. Okay. So there are a few things which I will be quickly revising for you. Okay. In the batch also, same chapter is going on. Okay. So I will be revising a few topics for you. You can catch up from there. Okay, no. Yes,
Okay.
Priyanka, how are you?
Good, sir. How are you?
Yes, I'm also good. So far, we have learned about blood, its function, what are the different components of the blood. We have learned about that, right? We learned that platelet, red blood cells, white blood cells, and fluid is present in the blood. We learned what are their functions. So far, we have learned about that. We had particularly learned where they these cells will be produced. So they are produced inside the bone marrow, the soft spongy tissue inside the hollow bones. Sorry about that. So that is the site of the production of all the cells. Further, we learned about the plasma also, which is basically the liquid component of the blood, right? So plasma makes up about 55 to 60% of 55% of the total blood in our body. Is basically made up of plasma, and plasma itself was made up of 95% of water, right? And several components like minerals, like protein, like fibrinogen, like water will be found in the plasma. We learned about white blood cells. They are basically the soldiers of the body that will be shielding you against infections. Further, we learned about the red blood cells. Scientifically, it is called as erythrocytes. We learned that it makes up about 44% of the total volume of the blood. It contains a red pigment by the name of. What's the name of the red pigment present in this? That is? Isn't it hemoglobin?
Yes, sir.
Okay, guys, get your notebook. Yeah, that is hemoglobin. Plus, we learned that. Abdul, does it have nucleus?
No.
No, right, Priyanka? So it does not have a nucleus, it lacks nucleus. Its lifespan is about 120 days. It will circulate in our blood for about 120 days. Okay.
Yes,
Then we
sir.
learned that oxygen will bind with the hemoglobin and form oxyhemoglobin. And in the form of oxyhemoglobin, oxygen will be traveling to different tissues inside the body. Further, we learned about blood platelets also. In blood platelets, what we learned that it is also scientifically called as thrombocytes. And they are the smallest of all the cells present in your blood. And wherever they will be bleeding in the body, wherever there's a cut, blood vessel is cut, artery or the vein is cut. So platelets will go there and it will bind with the red blood cells. It will form a clot, right? It will form a clot and hence will stop the bleeding in our body, right? That is something which we learned. Further, we did also, Abdul, from here, this will be new for you, right? We didn't learn about the blood vessels. Or did we learn about it? Were you there in the class? I suppose no, actually. So they are namely three.
Yeah, we didn't.
Yeah. So Priyanka was in Abdul. You two guys also turn your cameras on in the class, huh? Why you guys are very shy in the class? So they are kind of blood-filled tubes in the body. So arteries, veins, and capillaries were the namely three different blood vessels in our body. Particularly what we learned about arteries, that they will be taking the blood away from the heart. Right now, they will be taking the blood away from the heart. And we learned that there will be smaller arteries in our body called as arterioles. Like in this image, what we can see here, that take a look at this one over here. This is an artery. Abdul, particularly you also, you pay attention here. Others also. Abu Bakr, why he joins late? It's about already 6 minutes into the class. Okay, anyways, what I'm saying that this is the artery which is carrying the blood away from the heart. And it branches into smaller arteries. What do we call that? Yes, Goss? That is?
Say, arterioles.
Arterioles, no? So arteries will be further branching into arterioles as we learned about that. Okay. Also, what we know that the blood will be acting as a pumping machine and it will be pumping the blood into the artery with high pressure. So if it is pumping the blood into the artery with high pressure, so the artery will be thicker. If it is thinner, it will explode. It will basically rupture from different places. Okay, no? So that is one thing which we have learned. Further, we have learned that arteries will not have structures called as valves present in them. Okay. Because the blood will already be flowing in with high pressure. So let us learn about the veins. Then we will get back to this concept of valves further. Veins were the wide, thick wall blood vessels. You can look at the comparison of the thickness and the wideness of the artery and the vein. So while artery is narrower, if you were to look at it, it is narrower, but the walls are thick. It is narrower, but the walls are thick. There's a difference in these two things here, okay? It is narrower, meaning that the diameter is less, but the thickness is more, okay? But in the case of the veins, what we see that they are wider, they are more wider, but the wall are thin. So what the veins will do now, the veins will be bringing the deoxygenated blood from all the cells and the tissues of the body towards the heart. That is what the veins will be doing. And the flow of the blood will not be at very high pressure. It will not be flowing at a high pressure inside the vein. So thereby, that's why it is thin. Okay, now that's why biologically it is thin. Okay. Further, small veins will be called as venules. The small veins are called as venules. Look at this diagram again. So these are the small veins called as venules, which are joining together to form the vein. Okay, now which are joining together to form the vein. Getting it now, Abdul, Ghaz, Abu Bakr, and Priyanka.
Yeah.
So that is something which we learned. Okay. So in the veins, deoxygenated blood will be flowing. The blood which contains carbon dioxide and the waste material will be flowing. Okay. And it will not be flowing with high pressure. So if it is not flowing at high pressure, it can flow in the opposite direction also, because there is not a pumping organ which is pumping the blood into the vein now. Getting it now. So to prevent the backflow, there are special things inside the vein called as valves. While the blood will be flowing in the vein, the valves will be open like this, okay? And if the backflow of the blood, if the backflow of the blood will occur, then the valves will close itself. So thereby the blood will not flow in the backward direction. So this will only be present in the vein because the blood is not flowing at a high pressure inside the vein. But in the arteries, will they be present? Yes? In the arteries, they are not present. Okay, now because the blood is already flowing at high pressure in the artery, so there's no option of blood flowing in the backward direction. Abdul, you're getting what I'm trying to say, particularly you.
Yeah.
Got this now. So that is something which we learned. Further, we learned that veins are the only blood vessels that will be visible onto the surface of our skin. Okay, that is one thing. We sum up the differences between the two. So arteries, they have thicker walls while veins have thinner walls, right? Arteries don't have valves in them, but veins do have valves in them. The flow of blood is at high pressure inside the artery because heart is pumping the blood into that. But veins, the pressure is quite low. Arteries will be carrying oxygenated blood. The blood flowing in the artery will have oxygen in it. While veins, they carry deoxygenated blood. Blood will not have oxygen, but have carbon dioxide and other waste materials. Artery is carrying the blood away from the heart. It is carrying the blood away from the heart while the veins is bringing the blood towards the heart, right? Further, we learned that arteries are narrower, meaning that they are narrower, okay, now, but the veins are wider. You can relate it from this. The flow of water will be faster in a narrower pipe or in a wider pipe. Yes, you guys tell me this.
Sir, narrower pipe.
In the narrow pipe, no? So that is an advantage to the arteries. Okay, since they are carrying oxygenated blood to the organ, exactly. So they are carrying oxygenated blood towards the organs, towards the tissues. So hence they are narrower so that the flow of blood can be faster. So that is something which we have discussed. Further, we also have discussed about capillaries, which are the thinnest blood vessels out of the three. They are visible at different parts of the body. Like in certain people, it is visible at the ear pinna, and in the earlobe. In our eyes also, it is visible. So they are the smallest of the blood vessels and the thinnest of the blood vessels. And they will be kind of acting as a bridge between the artery and the vein. So the arterioles and venules here, they are together making up the blood vessel. So suppose this is a cell. The requirements of the cell are oxygen and food. So the artery further branches into the arterioles and it will be bringing the oxygen or food or water towards the cell. And cell will produce the waste material like carbon dioxide and other toxic waste. It will be taken away by the venules. Venules will further bring it to the veins, right? In which the deoxygenated blood will flow and it will go towards the heart. From the heart, it will go towards the lungs from where carbon dioxide will be separated from the blood. So it will be acting as a bridge between the artery and the vein, isn't it, guys? Abdul, you're getting it now. Priyanka, everyone. Right? So it will allow the food and oxygen to pass into the cell and it will take away the waste material from the cell. So that is something which we had learned. Further, we had also learned about this person. What was his contribution? Can you guys tell me? Those who have learned this from me.
Sir, he gave the ABO blood group system.
The name is Karl Landsteiner. Okay, no? So this person by the name of Karl Landsteiner, he is credited for giving the ABO blood group system, right? So this thing which we have learned, okay. In order to explain this topic to you, Abdul, I will be calling you someday 15 minutes prior to the given time. I will be asking you to stay in the class 15 minutes after some class. Okay, no? So this blood group system, just understand this much that there are 8 different blood types in our body. In the humans, there are 8 different blood types. Respectively, it is as follows. A positive, A negative. Take a look at this one. That will be giving you better clarity. Okay. Like you have A positive, A negative blood group. AB positive, AB negative. B positive, B negative. O positive and O negative. In total, how many of them are there? 4 plus 4, that is?
8
blood types, exactly. Okay. Now, especially we learned that some blood groups are special. Like some of them are universal blood. If someone has an O negative blood group, so they can donate it to anyone. Right now, they can donate it to anyone. So they are said to have a universal, they are universal blood donor. Okay, now. I suppose the last time I checked, I have O positive or O negative, I think. Okay. By the way, everyone should get their blood, they should know their blood group. Okay, now. In times, it can really be helpful in certain situations. Okay. Paul, if you know your blood groups or not?
Yes, sir.
Yes,
okay,
sir.
good.
Yes, sir.
While a person who has a blood group AB positive, they can receive blood from anyone. They can receive blood from any group. Okay, now. And the blood group AB negative, it is very rare. About less than 1% of the total population of the world has this AB negative blood group. Okay, no? So thereby, it can become really challenging if a person having an AB negative blood group suffers from some injury and losses the blood. So finding AB negative blood group can really be very difficult task. Okay. So those things we have learned. Further, we were learning about the pulse in the previous class. So what happens due to the pumping of the blood into the arteries by the heart? The heart pumps the blood into the arteries, no? Right? So at certain places in our body, like in our neck, like over here, okay, no? Over here or near the palm, we can feel some rhythmic throbbing. We can feel some movement. So that movement is because of the pumping of the blood into the artery. You can understand it in the following manner. So for example, if water is flowing into a pipe, so if you were to hold the pipe, will you not feel any movement in the pipe? You will feel obviously some movement, no? If you were to hold it in your hand, right? Plus, the blood that is flowing into the artery, it is not flowing in a very uniform fashion. When you look at the movement of the heart, it is contracting and relaxing, contracting and relaxing. Getting it, no? Contracting and relaxing. So due to this, a rhythmic throbbing will be felt in certain parts of the body, like for example, over here in near our palm. So that is called as pulse. That is called as pulse. Okay, now is that thing clear to everyone?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Further, pulse rate is basically defined as the number of pulse beats per minute, number of throbbing you will feel in 1 minute. In the previous class, I told you guys to observe the number of observe your pulse rate. Did you guys did that? You guys did that or not? Okay, you guys can do one thing. You guys have the stopwatch. You guys
yes,
have
sir.
It?
Yeah.
Huh? No. For those of
yeah.
you who for those of you who have it, first of all, place your fingers appropriately over here. Place it appropriately as it is shown over here. Okay, now. And tell me if you can feel any throbbing, if you can see observe any movement. Abdul and Abu Bakr, you guys also turn your cameras on. Ghaz,
yes.
You also. You guys can see, feel the movement, right? You have placed your fingers at the right position now? Okay. If you have, then set the timer.
Yes,
set
sir.
The timer to 1 minute, okay? Or just start the stopwatch. Okay, all of you do it together with me. I'm also doing it. And see how many beats you guys can count, okay? Count it. So let's start. All of you ready?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Abdul, you also ready now?
Yes, sir.
Okay, let's just start. Yes, all of you let me know. how much you got? I got 73 beats in 1 minute.
So I got 77.
Okay, cause you got 77. Tinker?
Sir?
Mm-hmm.
Sir, I didn't do it. I'm doing in this.
Okay. No. Yes, Abubakar?
Sir, 89.
89, okay. Abdul, what about you?
Me also 77.
Same, 89?
No, 77.
77, okay. Good.
Sir, for me, Abubakar, 89.
Oh, sorry. Mistakenly, I wrote. So for you, it's 89, okay. Right. So what we have observed here, that right now, this is the normal beat here. Normal beat is about like usually between 70 to 80s, okay, or it could be between 60 to 100, okay, nah? Usually it's between 60 to 100. So that's the normal pulse rate, okay, that's the normal pulse rate. Also, this pulse rate which we have learned, it is basically the same as the heart rate. Whether you call the pulse rate or whether we call this as the heart rate, both of them are the same thing, pulse rate or the heart rate. So pulse rate, the heart rate, both of them will be measuring how many times your heart will be beating in 1 minute. How many times your heart will be beating in 1 minute. Got this now? So that is the case about the pulse rate. Let me define this. And you guys will be, I will be putting the screenshot. You guys will be writing it after the class. Okay. So pulse rate or the heart rate is defined as the number of pulse beats per minute, okay, and the normal pulse rate of human being usually what we know that it is between 60 to 100, okay, now 60 to 100 beat per minute. Human being is 60 to 100 beats per minute. Any questions from this? And we can take the pulse rate reading now from various positions in our body. From the neck also, we can read this, okay, now. From there also, we can read this. Now let us learn about the heartbeat. So heartbeat, sir? Basically, yes.
So what happens if you have lot?
Like what, sir, will happen if you have low pulse rate?
No, right? For example, someone has like pulse rate of 77. Someone has a pulse rate of 87. So what is the difference?
There is not much difference, okay, no? There is not much difference, and even we won't feel that much of difference, okay, no? Externally, we won't feel much difference, okay? That is the case here. But say, for example, if the pulse rate drops, or pulse rate, or basically heart rate, if it drops, so person can develop a pain in their chest. They can be a chest pain, right? A person can start to faint. You guys understand a faint? F-A-I-N-T, faint. Faint or might feel dizzy, or he can suffer from shortness of breath, right? Now, so that are the problems that can happen. Also, if the pulse rate increases, that will also cause some problem. Right? For example, if someone is having high blood pressure, so the pulse rate is going to increase. If someone is having high blood pressure, if you were to check their pulse rate, it will be higher. It will be higher. Getting it now? So if the pulse rate is very high, it can lead to a stroke also, or basically cardiac arrest also, right now, in which the heart will stop functioning. Got this? No. So that is only. So it is important that the pulse rate remains in the normal range. That is between 60 to 100.
Sir, so is it good if you have?
If you have.
like your pulse rate health is not 60, but your pulse rate is 70.
Yeah, it is completely okay. It is completely okay to have pulse range between the range of, if it is in between lying between 60 to 100, then it is okay. Okay.
No, sir. So, like, is it good that
Abu Bakr, your voice is not stucking. Your voice is stucking. Check your network connection.
For example, sir, someone has.
Abu Bakr, do one thing. Your voice is stucking. Just type the question in the chat box. I will see it from there. I can't hear the complete sentence you're saying. Okay. Yes. Talking about the heartbeat. Abu Bakr, I'm continuing from here. Please write the question in the chat box. Talking about the heartbeat, basically what happens? If you have to look at the movement of the heart, this is the movement done by the heart. It will be contracting and relaxing. And due to the contraction and relaxation, or contraction or expansion of the heart, of the muscles of the heart, it will be pumping the blood into the arteries. It will be pumping the blood into the arteries. And while doing this kind of movement, it produces a sound also. And the sound produced by the heart is lub-dub sound. The sound is called as lub-dub sound is produced by the human heart. Okay. So the muscles of the heart would be relaxing and contracting continuously as it will be pumping the blood into the heart, into the arteries. And this rhythmic contraction, it is happening in a rhythm, no? In a rhythmic manner, it is happening. So this rhythmic contraction and relaxation of the heart is called as heartbeat. This rhythmic contraction and relaxation of the heart is called as heartbeat. And under 1 minute, under 1 minute, it will be doing several movements. Got this now? What it is? Is the concept of heartbeat clear to everyone?
Yes, sir.
Right. So what is it? Define the heartbeat. Yes. Also important thing I was about to say that under 1 minute, basically the number of heartbeats now, number of heartbeat per minute is between 70 to 80. So 70 to 80 beats per minute is the normal heartbeat. Okay, no? That is the case. So what are we saying about heartbeat? As a bit of, okay, if someone has a pulse rate of 60 and the other person has a pulse rate of 70 or 80 in some way, is the other person better than the first person? See, usually we can see that there's a slight difference. I mean to say, in a slight manner, we can say that the heart is functioning more normally. Okay, we can see that the pulse rate is more normal if it is between 70 to 80. So someone who has a pulse rate of 60 or someone who has a pulse rate of 70 or 80, the person who is having a pulse rate of 70 to 80, is his heart is functioning in a better manner. Getting it? So that would be the answer to the question. Got this, Abu Bakr?
Yes.
Okay. Coming back to the question which we will, the topic which we were learning about the heartbeat. So due to the rhythmic contraction and expansion of the muscles of the heart, it will be pumping the blood into the arteries. It will be pumping the blood into the artery. And in under 1 minute, how many beats will be done? It will be between 70 to 80. So heartbeat was the rhythmic contraction and relaxation of the muscles of the heart because with the help of this, it will be pumping blood throughout our body. Got this so far now? Next, we are going to learn about stethoscope. So stethoscope is a medical instrument with the help of which we will be able to hear the sounds that are produced inside the human body. So that is the basically what happens inside our body. Also, certain sounds are produced. So we will be able to hear it with the help of stethoscope, right? So it's a medical tool basically that will be used to listen to the sounds that is produced inside our body. Like as the heartbeat will produce some sound, the lubbed up sound is produced by the heartbeat, isn't it? The lubbed up sound is produced while we are breathing. At that time also sound is produced, isn't it? Other organs, like every organ in our body, particularly most of the organs in our body will be producing some sounds. Got this, no? And doctor, with the help of the stethoscope, will listen to the sound. He will listen to the sound, and with the help of the sound that he will listen, like the type of sound that he will listen from the heart or from the lungs, he will be able to determine how well our lungs or how well our heart is functioning. Got this or not, what I'm trying to say? Yes. Further, they will be using this to check the blood pressure also. They use stethoscope to check the blood pressure as well. So stethoscope is a medical instrument that is used to listen to the heartbeat of a person, right? And how it will be listening? He will be putting the ear tips into the ear. This is the tube. This is the diaphragm that is put either put on the chest or the back of the person. So you might wonder, like as a kid, you might have wondered that why the doctor is putting this on the heart, on the chest, or on the back of the person. What is the listening? So he's actually listening to the internal sounds of the body. The heart is producing some sound while breathing. Also, sound is produced by the lungs. Other organs will also produce some sound. Also, what will happen now? The sound will be amplified. Here, with the help of this diaphragm, the sound will be amplified. Because the sound that is produced inside our body, it is not a very high frequency sound. It is not a very loud sound now. So if it's a very, very weak sound, we will not be able to hear it. So with the help of this, the sound will be amplified. Getting what I'm trying to say? In the sound devices, there is an amplifier now, which increases the loudness of the sound. Right? So with the help of this stethoscope, the sound produced by the heart or the lungs or other sounds produced inside the body will be amplified. It will be amplified to hear it properly. So it contains two ear tips that goes into the ear. There's a tube that will be connecting the diaphragm to this ear tip. Okay, and this diaphragm is sensitive to the sound. It will be carrying the catching the sound. Is that much clear to everyone so far what we have learned here? Yes.
Sure.
Also, I wanted to tell you about an important process or important medical field called is auscultation, or basically a technique. So there is a technique, a special technique. Called auscultation. This is a special technique called as auscultation. It involves the act of listening to the sounds that is produced inside our body. So this is the technique with the help of which we'll be listening to the sound produced inside our body. It is usually done with the help of a stethoscope. Okay, and there are some other machines also that will be used to listen to the internal sounds, but generally this is used. Okay, the special technique called auscultation is used to listen to internal sounds produced in the body. So that is the case here. Let me put the screenshot of this. Did I put the screenshot of this one? You guys can save the screenshots in your devices, and after the class, make sure to note it accordingly. Prepare the notes, okay? So the heart rate and the pulse rate, both of them are basically the same thing, okay, no? So both of them will be determining each other. So there's a relationship between the heart rate and the pulse rate. A heartbeat and the pulse rate, I mean to say. Okay. So heart rate and the pulse rate. So pulse rate will be almost exactly equal to the heartbeat. The relation between the pulse rate and the heart rate is, no? they will be almost equal to each other. Getting it? What I'm trying to say? The relation between this. So they are the same thing. And they both measures how many times our heart would be beating in a minute. Okay. And the measurement of the heart rate and the pulse rate, both of them will be between 60 to 100. 60 to 100. So while we are checking the pulse rate now, we are getting that we are actually checking the heart rate as well. While we check the pulse rate, we are actually checking the heart rate also. So this will give you direct information about your heart rate. Checking the pulse rate, like right now you guys did this exercise. For me, it came 73 beats per minute. Some of you, it was 89, 77, like this. So that was giving you the information about the heart rate, actually. It was giving you direct information about the heart rate, the rate at which your heart was beating. Getting it, everyone? Yes, Gauss, Priyanka, Abubakar, and Abdul.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
So the relation between them is that it should not be heartbeat over here. It should be heart rate, actually. So they are exactly equal to each other. Further, some of the important facts is that every day our heart would be beating about 1 lakh times. How many? 1 lakh times. And it will be pumping the blood, about 2000 gallons of blood will be pumped about the by the heart in 1 minute. How much? About 2000 gallons of blood will be pumped by the heart in 1 minute. Okay, now. So that is one thing. During the day, actually 2000 gallons of blood will be pumped. In 1 minute, it will be equal to 1.5 gallons. Okay. So it's not like 1.5 gallon of, it's not, it does not mean that 2000 gallons of blood is present in our body. Getting what I'm trying to say? It says that it will be pumped through the heart. 2000 gallons of blood will be pumped through the heart. But that doesn't mean that this much of blood is present in our body. So how much of blood is present in our body? Roughly between 4.5 to 5.5 liter of blood is present inside the fully grown adult human being. Got this, everyone? And gallon is a bigger unit of volume, by the way. Okay. You guys know like how many liters are there in 1 gallon? Yes. This is about 3.7 liters of blood in 1 gallon. Got this, Sundi? 3.7 liter of blood is there in 1 gallon. So that is the case. Further, it would be circulating blood through 60,000 miles of blood vessels in your body. Meaning that if all the blood vessels were to be spread, if it were to be spread out, it will make about 70,000 miles. It will be 60,000 miles in length. So can we say that the blood is circulating through the 60 miles of blood vessels in our body, isn't it? So these are some of the general facts, some important extra facts. Okay, now you can memorize it or you can leave it. Okay. Next, we're going to learn about the concept of the blood pressure. So blood pressure basically tells you about the force. It's basically the force exerted by the blood against the wall of the arteries. So what happens here? As the heart would be pumping the blood into the arteries. So thereby the walls of the artery would be under some pressure. Try to understand it in this manner. That this is the heart, for example. And it is pumping the blood into the artery. Right. So the blood will be exerting pressure on the walls of the artery also. Now this is the wall of the artery. So the blood will be exerting some pressure in it or not? Yes. It will be exerting pressure on the wall of the artery or not? Let me know. Yes, Abdul, you there in the class? Pay attention here. So because of the force exerted by the blood onto the walls of the artery, a pressure will be generated. That will be called as blood pressure. So as the force will be exerted by the blood against the wall of artery, so thereby blood pressure will be generated. So it's the force exerted by the blood against the wall of the artery. Again, you can understand it in this manner. For example, you are holding a pipe in your hand in which water is flowing at some pressure. So thereby, the water pressure will be the concept there. There will be some water pressure. In the similar manner, there will be blood pressure as well. Okay. Now, blood pressure, sometime it will increase, sometime it will decrease. So when it will increase, that will be called as high blood pressure, or simply it is hypertension. So imagine that if the pressure inside the blood increases, so there will be, if the blood pressure increases, so will it not be problematic for the arteries? Arteries will be under more stress now. Yes or no? If the blood pressure increases, if the blood pressure is high, so your arteries will be under more pressure. It will be under more stress. Got this, guys?
Yes, sir.
Again, you can take the same example as I have given, that if the flow of the water in the pipe increases, so there will be more stress on the wall of the water pipe, right? No? So that is the case. So that will be called as hypertension. Okay. Also, some amount of pressure is necessary for the flow of the blood. Otherwise, how will the blood flow? Or sometimes the blood pressure can decrease also. So that will also be problematic. So blood pressure can increase and decrease both, depending upon several reasons. It can depend upon your diet. It can depend upon your lifestyle. Okay, no? That is one thing. Or it will depend upon your sleep also. If you are not taking adequate amount of sleep, or if someone is consuming like alcohol. Okay. So on that basis, it will be determined. Further, there are two types of blood pressure. There are two types of blood pressure. Okay, no? So there is, one is systolic, another one is diastolic. So when there will be maximum pressure in the artery, try to understand it in this manner, that when your heart will be contracting, so the pressure in the artery will be high, isn't it? When your heart is contracting, so the pressure in the artery will be high, isn't it? Try to understand it in this manner. For example, if you were to take a bottle filled with water, so if you're going to contract it, you're going to contract it, compress it, and connect a pipe to this. Let me just show you this. Like, for example, if you have taken a bottle of water, and in this you have connected a tube. Now you're going to compress it. So it will become like this. And the water will start to come out of it, isn't it? Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
So water will come out from the tube, or basically water will flow in the tube with high pressure when the water bottle is being contracted, when it is being compressed. Now release it. If the bottle is in normal position like this, so will the flow of water in this pipe be at high pressure?
No,
right now? So pressure is low in this case now. Pressure is low. So when your heart would be contracting, when the heart will be contracting, so the pressure of blood in the artery will be? Yes?
So it will be more.
It will be more, exactly. And while the heart will be relaxing, it will not be contracting, while it will be in a rest position. So the pressure will be?
Less.
So that is the systolic, when the pressure is high. Okay, and another one is diastolic, that is the 80. So whenever you get your blood pressure checked now, whenever your parents get the blood pressure checked or someone gets it, so you will see two readings. You might have seen this, right? So that is the normal blood pressure, by the way, 120 by 80. 120 is the systolic blood pressure, 80 is the diastolic blood pressure. So 120, you will be getting this reading because of the contraction of the heart. Okay, now? And this is basically while the heart would be relaxing, relaxation or expansion of the heart. So that was some general things which I have told you. Okay, now although these questions are not asked in that much of detail, but just for the sake of general knowledge, I thought you guys should know about these things. Okay, now. So what are the two types of blood pressure, guys?
Sir, one is normal.
Systolic and diastolic.
Exactly, systolic and diastolic. Okay.
Okay.
I'm going to put the screenshots. In this one, only this paragraph is important for you guys. Okay, now, blood pressure is the force exerted by blood against the wall of the artery as the heart would be pumping the blood into the circulatory system.
Okay, sir.
Now let's learn about the pulmonary circuit. Okay, now. So take a look at this diagram first of all of you pay attention here. So what we are seeing here, that there's a circuit. The term circuit, I suppose you should be familiar with it. Circuit, you'd have learned about this term in the chapter electricity, where all the electrical components are connected via the wires, etc., like that. So in the pulmonary circuit, what we are seeing, that basically in this concept, we will learn that that the different organs, like particularly the heart and the lungs and the blood vessels, will be connected together, and that will form a pulmonary circuit. So in the pulmonary circuit, first of all, take a look at the heart. So the heart will be pumping the blood. It will be pumping the blood into the arteries. Look at this one here. Heart is the pumping the blood, so it goes into this one. Okay? The red one. What is the red one here? Yes?
Sir, the veins.
No. It's artery, no?
Oh,
heart,
yes,
pumps the blood into the artery. So in the artery, blood having high amount of oxygen is flowing and low amount of carbon dioxide. Basically, this is oxygenated blood flowing into this. What kind of blood is flowing? Oxygenated blood is flowing into this. And where will the oxygenated blood go? It will go to the body now. Right? Everyone turn their cameras on in the class. So oxygenated blood will go into the body. By body, we refer to different tissues in the body. Everywhere in the body, you can refer it to. And what will happen in the tissues inside our body, in the cells, what will happen? So it will be getting oxygen, but it will be giving out waste materials now, right? Like, for example, it will release the carbon dioxide into the blood. Getting it now. So arteries will be pumping the blood towards the body. I mean to say, the heart will be pumping the blood into the artery, which will bring the oxygenated blood to the different cells of the body. Okay. Further, what will happen inside our body? The cells will be releasing waste materials like carbon dioxide, which will go into the veins. Where does it go? It goes into the veins. And veins will be now carrying the waste materials. It will be carrying the waste material towards the heart. The vein will be carrying the waste material like carbon dioxide towards the heart. And where is the heart sending it to? It is sending it towards the lungs now. Getting it, guys? It is sending it towards the lungs, right? So that makes up the pulmonary circuit in our body. This makes up the pulmonary circuit. So it's the network of arteries and veins that connects to the heart and the lungs. Deoxygenated blood is pumped from the heart. Deoxygenated blood, like in this vein, deoxygenated blood is flowing. So deoxygenated blood basically means that in this, there will be high concentration of carbon dioxide now. There will be high amount of carbon dioxide in this. So it will be brought to the heart, and heart will be now pumping it back to the lungs. Why? So that from the lungs, the gaseous exchange takes place in the lungs now, isn't it, guys? So the gaseous exchange will take place in the lungs, from where carbon dioxide will be removed. Also the air that we are inhaling, the oxygen will be taken out from that air and it will go into this blood vessel. Later on, I'll be telling you the name of this blood vessel. Okay, no? This will be the, we'll be learning about this. So it will be bringing that oxygenated blood towards the heart and heart will be now pumping that oxygenated blood to the different parts of the body. So that makes up a circuit system that we are calling as a pulmonary circuit. So it is the network of arteries and veins that will be connected with the heart and the lungs and our body as well. Deoxygenated blood is pumped from the heart to the lungs for oxygenation. Okay. Plus the oxygenated blood returns to the heart to be pumped to the rest of the body. So oxygenated blood is coming from the lungs now. What kind of blood will be coming from the lung towards the heart? It will be oxygenated blood as we are inhaling. Exactly. As we are doing inhalation. So in the act of inhalation, we take in oxygen-rich air now. We are taking in oxygen-rich air.
Yes, sir.
And inside our lungs, what will happen? The gaseous exchange will take place and the oxygen will go into the blood now. O2, that is oxygen. And that oxygenated blood will be brought towards the heart. And the heart will now pump it to the different organs. So that is the case, okay? We will learn about now the, now we will be learning about the structure of the heart. Okay, now this concept of pulmonary circuit, there are a few important topics, a few important things in this which I haven't told you about yet. Like what will be the name of this blood vessel and this blood vessel. Okay, now that is left to be discussed. In order to make you understand that, first we are going to take a look at the structure of the human heart. Okay. Just one, let me clean this. Now, when we look at the human heart, it's a quite complex organ. It is divided into four chambers. It is divided into four chambers. So these four chambers, so you can think of them as small room-like structures. This is the first chamber. I'm going to shade them using different colors. This is the first chamber. That is the second chamber of the heart. And this one here is the third. And that one is the fourth chamber. So in total, how many chambers are there in the human heart? Yes?
Four.
Chambers. Good. Now the upper chambers, they are called as atrium. The upper chambers are called as atrium. Okay, no? So in the human heart, right now we are learning about the structure of the human heart. So there are four chambers. There are two upper chambers and two lower chambers. Now the upper chambers are together called as atrium. Upper chambers, what do we call them? They are called as atrium. A-T-R-I-U-M. Respectively, they are the left and the right atrium. Left atrium and the right atrium. Okay, now? So, it is left atrium. And the B1 is right atrium. Okay. Next, you have the lower chamber. Can you look at the name of the lower chamber? What do we call them together? They are ventricles. Okay, now? So, lower chambers. In the lower chamber, there are two chambers. Respectively, they are called as ventricles. Together, we call them as ventricle. Respectively, again, you have the left ventricle. And then you have the right ventricle. Now, in between all these chambers, there's a muscular wall. In between all these chambers, there's a muscular wall. Look at where I'm pointing here. Yes, Abdul, Priyanka, Vas, and Abu Bakr. This muscular wall that is present here, that is being called as septum. And it has a very important role to play as it will prevent the oxygenated and deoxygenated blood from mixing. We'll be learning about that in a minute. Okay. Now, take a look at this animation, everyone. Look at this carefully. What are these two chambers called? This one and this one?
Sir, atrium.
Yes, Priyanka?
Yes, sir.
Right? Abdul, that is atrium, everyone. And the two chambers below them, this one?
Ventricles.
They are ventricles, very good. And there's a muscular structure, isn't it? This muscular structure? Okay. It is present behind this structure also. It is not visible, but this muscular structure, this is septum. Okay, and this is septum. Now let's continue further in this. Take a look at this from here. So the blood is entering into these chambers. The blood is entering into these chambers. Okay, now the red and the blue color is depicting the entry of the blood into this. Okay. So the blood has entered into this. Now you guys pay attention here. So the blood are moving from one chamber to another, right? Observe how the blood is moving from one chamber to another, right now. It goes from one chamber to another. Got this so far? Okay. Now let us understand like how exactly will the what kind of blood will be flowing from where to where, etc. Right. So first of all, what will happen here? In the atrium, basically, the atrium or the upper chamber, it will receive the blood, it will receive the deoxygenated blood from various parts of the body. What will happen? It will receive the deoxygenated blood from the body, respectively the left atrium and the right atrium. They will receive the deoxygenated blood from different parts of the body. While the lower chambers, that is ventricle, they will contain oxygenated blood. They will be receiving oxygen-rich blood. That first thing is clear to everyone or not? What kind of blood is being received by the upper chamber, that is the atrium? They're getting deoxygenated. Exactly, deoxygenated blood. And as for the lower chamber, they're getting
oxygenated
blood. So deoxygenated blood will be brought into the upper chambers from where? From where it will be coming? Think logically. From the body, isn't it? It will be coming from the body now.
Yes,
and
sir.
The oxygenated blood from the, like, which organ will be getting you oxygen? Which organ will get oxygen for you? Isn't it quite obvious?
So the lungs.
Lungs, no, exactly. Okay, guys, you're putting your laptop in charge. Okay, that was 8 minutes ago. Anyways, so that is something which we have learned so far. Further, these openings that you're seeing here now, these are actually the blood vessels. These are some blood vessels, okay? Call us this one and look at this one here. Right now, pay attention to this one only, okay, now? So this vein is called as vena cava. What do we call them as? This is vena cava. So vena cava will be bringing the deoxygenated blood from the body. This one will be bringing the deoxygenated blood from the upper part of the body. From the upper part of the body, like from here to here, the blood, deoxygenated blood from our face, from our upper part of the body, basically will be brought to the atrium via the vena cava. That thing should be clear. And from our abdomen area, from our lower area, lower part of the body, the deoxygenated blood will be brought via the via this vena cava. Got this so far, no?
Right.
Okay. Now further, what will happen as it will be brought here, also pay attention to this one also, like the pulmonary veins here, the particularly this pulmonary vein here in the left atrium. Okay, they will also be bringing the blood. Okay, so what is happening here, the atrium and the ventricles, both of them are divided, as we have learned here, and both of them are divided into different chambers. From the left ventricle, particularly what will happen, from the left ventricle, the biggest artery of our body, the biggest artery inside our body called as aorta is connected. It is starting from the left ventricle. All of you shift your attention to this point here. From the left ventricle, the biggest artery in our body called as aorta is connected. It is beginning from here. And again, getting back to the right atrium, it will be receiving deoxygenated blood from the body through the vein called as vena cava, as we have learned. And the vena cava is the biggest vein present in our body. It is the biggest vein present in our body. So it will receive the blood into this. And from here, it will go into the right ventricle. From here, it will go into the right ventricle. But getting this. And from right ventricle, it will go into this artery. They call this pulmonary artery, from where it will be going to different parts of the body. Let's do one thing. We'll be continuing from here in the next class. Okay, now this human heart topic will take about 15 to 20 minutes to complete. So we couldn't complete it today. We'll be learning about that in the next class. Okay.
Okay, sir.
What you guys would be required to do, make sure to draw a diagram of the human heart in your notebooks. Okay. I'm going to put the screenshot.